Hello, everyone. So you want to be a software developer, and you've got this brilliant idea for a project, and you know just how to build it. So you're going to crank up your development environment and start whacking away, putting code in, and next thing you know, you'll have your brilliant application that you've decided to build. Except you probably won't. You're probably going to fall into the trap that so many fall into, especially amateur coders, and that is you're going to end up probably picking an unfortunate programming language for your project, but even the pros do that. And you're almost certainly going to end up with some sort of cargo cult programming or copy-paste programming or something like that, where you just whack on things until it actually appears to do what you want it to do. And the real temptation here is you'll go out to Google, you'll search for how to blah in blah, where blah is what you're doing and blah is your programming language, and you'll find probably a link to Stack Overflow or something like that, which will have a code snippet in there, which will depend on some library or other. So you'll dutifully copy that in, shove it in your code, and now you've got library import and all, and now you've got your first dependency. And if you don't understand what this code you've pasted in there is doing, you could get into even more trouble later. But after several dozen iterations of this, searching Google, finding a Stack Overflow article or question or something, and copy-pasting some code in there, maybe tweaking it a bit randomly until it works, you've got, you've accumulated maybe 50 dependencies on third-party libraries or modules or whatever your programming language calls it. I'm going to call them modules. So you've picked up these dependencies on 50 different modules that you didn't write, and you don't even understand what they do. You're just copy-pasting code that happens to use them. And now you've probably got your application mostly working by this point. It's doing something at least. And now you need to arrange for it to turn into some sort of a thing that you can actually, put up somewhere and people can download and use, say. Assuming this isn't just something for your own benefit, if it's something you're doing just for your own benefit, it doesn't matter how lousy the code is or how many dependencies it has, because you're the only one that has to deal with this. Now, that's all fine, but now you're going to distribute it to other people. So you crank up some documentation and you find out how you turn your thing into a module or something like that that you can put up on some repository, and now people can run your thing just by using the usual incantation to install a module for their programming language, their environment for that programming language, and everything's good, right? Your application works, and you have it out there, and maybe by some fluke people start using it, and then you start getting bug reports where X doesn't work or Y doesn't work or Z doesn't work, and you're baffled by this, but you plug away at it and you kind of plug those problems, and maybe you accumulate a couple more dependencies along the way. And then you put your new version out there, and then you get bug reports, lather, rinse, repeat. And next thing you know, by the time you're on version 5 or 10 of your software, you've accumulated another 25 or 30 dependencies because you keep going out to Stack Overflow and seeing, Google, and then Stack Overflow and seeing some snippet of code that solves your problem and uses yet another dependency, and next thing you know, you're up to 75 or 80 or 100 dependencies. Now, this can continue forever, right? You add new code, you fix bugs, and somehow you end up accumulating dependencies because you find, oh, well, this module does what I need, this module does what I need. And by the time you're done, you just have a massive collection of dependencies with some glue between them, which is the code that you've stolen from Stack Overflow and massaged a bit. And great, maybe you've got some useful piece of software. And maybe it works well, or maybe it doesn't. But maybe you've managed to plug all of the critical bugs and everything's working reasonably well for your users. Okay, great, now you can relax. And because you're using this packaging system, module distribution network, or whatever it is, people can install it easily. It doesn't matter how many dependencies it has. Okay. So you're fine, you're happy, your software's working, so you relax a bit and go on to your next project or binge something on Netflix or whatever. And then sometime later, you start getting bug reports again. But you haven't changed anything, and it was working, so you write them off, but you keep getting them. And then you start looking, and you find out that some module that you depend on has changed somehow, and now the latest version doesn't work. So now you have to work out how to make that work. Luckily, someone has a module that will serve as a shim and make everything work. Or maybe it's just a simple code change and you just screwed up something in the past or whatever. Fine, you fix that and your code's good. Or your software's good, release a new version. A little while later, something else breaks, and it's in the third-party dependency. But this time, it's a dependency of the dependency. And now what do you do? You really can't fix that one, so it gets really, really frustrating. And then you start fiddling around, and maybe you find a workaround, and everything's good. And then this starts accumulating more and more of this stuff over time, and now you're software project gets more and more complicated with all of these kludges and workarounds and fixes for these third-party modules. And by the time the dust settles, and after a few iterations of this, you realize that you can't even maintain your code anymore. It's a big mess. And your software is getting slower and slower and slower. This is definitely not good. And now you sit back and you start thinking, well, what can I do about that? Now, by this time, you've gotten a little better at programming, so you have some idea what these things you're grabbing from Stack Overflow actually mean. And you start going through some of these bits that you've got in there you got from there, and you start wondering, well, what's going on here? And then you start drilling down into it, and you think, well, you know, this is a lot of work. And then you have this brilliant idea. Let me just install a fresh copy of my software and see what happens. So you do that. You crank up a clean development environment. You install your software in there. And then you discover that not only did the 75 or 80 dependencies that you explicitly have get installed, but about 1,800 other ones did underneath that. And by the time you're done, you discovered that your cool little software program installed completely actually installs 25 or 30,000 files, many of which are one or two lines of code. And now you have a clue as to why your software is so slow. On every operating system I'm familiar with, opening a file is an expensive operation compared to just reading stuff from a file you've already opened. And that's because the system has to go and find the file by its file name and then perform all of the bookkeeping to give you a file handle you can operate on. And it has to do that for every file you open. Even if you open it, read it, and close it, you have to. Have you ever wondered why Windows copying files goes quite quickly when you've got a few big files but takes a couple of months of Sundays, if you've got a whole bunch of little files, this is why. And no operating system is immune to this. I just pick on Windows because it's the one that's notorious for slow file copies, and unpredictable time remaining results. But this is why. So if your program has to open up 10,000 files just to start up, it's going to take a fair while to start. And if you're ever wondering why some of these commercial programs, whatever, take so long to start, that's probably a good indicator if there's too many files being loaded. It's not always the reason, but it often is. Okay, so you discover that, and then you start looking through, since you're a little more familiar with programming, you're looking at what some of these modules that you're depending on actually do. You're looking at your code, and you discover that one of them, you can just replace it with a single line of code in your programming language, and it does exactly the same thing and doesn't depend on anything. So you do that. And you don't notice any appreciable difference in speed, but you've taken one dependency off. So, and for kicks, you do another reinstall clean, and doesn't really seem to make a huge difference in the pile of stuff installed. Well, you start looking through and you find more and more of these things where you're depending on some module to do something, where it's really a trivial thing, and you can either write yourself a function that does it in two or three or four lines, or you can simply put the code that does it right there instead of having to import some sort of module and then use it, right? And as you start going through and looking at these things, you realize that a lot of the cases where you had all of these special cases and kludges and workarounds in there, that code goes away because now you have a predictable situation and you can just write the code that works properly, directly. And finally, you get religion and you start doing this systematically. And of course, you're being careful and testing everything along the way. And then by the time you're done, you realize that your software is actually not significantly larger, your program itself. In fact, it might be smaller once you take all the workarounds and kludges out. But it's immensely faster, and now it has half a dozen third-party dependencies instead of 80 or 90, and those dependencies have, whatever they have. But now your software runs hugely faster, and it installs faster, and it has less dependencies that can break and therefore cause you to have to do work to fix things. Now, you'll note that I said that there's still a few dependencies. Well, some dependencies make sense. If you're doing something, that's non-trivial or complicated or difficult, a third-party dependency that does it well, like a module that does it well, is probably worth using as long as it's readily available. It's not hard to obtain. And that's actually a good reason to have a third-party dependency. If you're depending on a module that implements 800 functions and you use only one of them, that's a bad dependency because you're now importing that 800 functions when you only need one. But if you're, say it's a balanced binary tree implementation, let's just say, say it's an AVL tree. Those things are bloody hard to get right because just understanding what's going on with them is difficult. Even if you really understand binary trees, it's still a little confusing how the actual algorithms for rebalancing the tree work. So having a library that does AVL trees might be well worth using if you're depending on those things to make some data structure a lot more efficient. And there's a whole lot of other things like that where it might make some sense. You know, and this is assuming that your programming language itself doesn't have implementations of those. So that type of dependency makes sense, where you're actually using the dependency appropriately and fairly heavily. But if it's something simple like determining if you've got an array or a string in your scalar or in your variable, you know, is it scalar or an array? Is it a string? Whatever. That is almost certainly better done as part of the programming language, like directly. Just write the code that does it directly. And if the code is a little bit complicated, then make a function that does it. But having a third-party dependency just for that is kind of dumb. It's something that if you're competent with your programming language, you should be able to do in a couple of lines of code. You might as well just do it because you can be pretty certain it's correct. And depending on a whole other module just for two lines of code is kind of excessive. Now, you might be saying, but why? But isn't it a good idea to have relatively small things that do one thing well and then glue them together, like the Unix philosophy, where you have on the command line where you've got a whole bunch of programs that do one thing well and then you can glue them together with pipes and so on? Well, yeah, that's a good idea. But you'll note that these utilities are actually doing something that's not trivial. It may look like it, but they're actually doing something, some relatively complicated task. But that's all they do. They're doing one task. And that's fine. They work pretty well, and they're all doing things that work well in a filter arrangement, right? Where you take it takes input from one side and puts output on the other side, and you're done, right? That stuff, it all works well together because it's all stuff that really works as in that type of environment. But the whole idea that every function should be written once and you never write it again, that's taking it a little bit too far. Trivial stuff, you should not be afraid to write again and again and again. And in a lot of programming, well, let's take a look at low-level languages like C. Linked lists are something that you can, the code for managing them is trivial. And once you are familiar with it, you can write it again and again and again and again and again. And having a library to do a linked list actually is a lot more complicated to deal with than just having a linked, just having the pointers and dealing with it in C. It gets more complicated when you start using structures like trees, binary trees, say. But even then, a simple binary tree, you can probably implement yourself. A priority queue, you can probably implement yourself. There's a whole lot of relatively common data structures and so on, you could probably implement yourself and not have to worry about having an extra dependency for doing that. On the other hand, there's a lot of things that are more complicated, and it might make sense to have a library that provides a whole bunch of widgets for a GUI interface. So you don't have to deal with all of the complexities of screen layout and all of that yourself. You'll probably screw it up. So a GUI library makes sense. And that's things like GTK and Qt, things like that. That sort of thing, that's a logical thing to have a library for. Now, I'm not going to go into specific details on this you should have a library and this you shouldn't. It does come down to a judgment call. As an example, string manipulation. If your application does a lot of string manipulation, a huge amount of it, and there's a string library that makes that manipulation easy and convenient and reasonably efficient, then it might make sense to use that. But if you only occasionally use a string in any way other than as a constant in the code or something, let's say you're using C, then you might as well just stick with C-style strings, because you're not going to have a benefit by depending on a large external string manipulation library if you only deal with two or three strings, right, over the course of your program. It's a judgment call. Sometimes it'll make sense to use a particular library, sometimes it won't, and you have to look at your specific situation. Now, I've been talking about dependencies that your software requires to run. There's other dependencies that you might fall into the trap of using as well, and that's software needed to build your software. Now, at some point, you're going to have to depend on some sort of a build system if your software gets non-trivial. And that's perfectly reasonable. But depending on weird build systems or custom build systems or build systems that nobody has, if you're distributing source code, it's probably not a good idea. It's okay, you know, to use something like, to rely on Make and the C compiler and that sort of thing for something you're going to distribute to Unix-like systems. It's probably reasonable to rely on something like AutoConf or what have you from the GNU project to deal with some of the dependency detection and so on. But if you're going to use some extra tool, make sure it's readily available, findable, or it comes with your software package. So if you have a custom, machine description generator for your some compiler scheme or something you've written, and you need to have that to actually build your software, then distribute that with the software so that, and then you can build it, use it, and then not install it because it's not useful elsewise. You know, things like that. Don't make people download an extra package from you just to be able to build your software. That's frustrating. If it's a tool that has more general utility, that might be reasonable. But think hard. Do you really need the functionality of that tool? And if not, you might be better off not to rely on it. Now, again, if this software is only for your own benefit, then maybe it doesn't matter so much. You can use whatever you want. But do yourself a favor later when you come back and fiddle with the software in 5 or 6 years' time and you don't remember anything. Keep your number of build time dependencies down. Keep the requirements for the build environment, relatively small. If you can do that, then life gets a lot easier. If you can list the requirements to set up a functional build environment in 5 or 6 lines in a README file, you're probably okay, even if you're depending on some less usual build system like Jam or CMake or something like that. If you can at least describe it quickly so that people that get baffled can look in the README and go, oh, okay, I just need this thing, install it, and I'm good. Everything's fine. But if you do something like the build environment that OpenOffice required years ago to even come close to building, well, yeah, that's not so good. The barrier to entry for trying to do code development for OpenOffice was so high because the build environment was so detailed and confusing and so on, that nobody could deal with it, right? So that's the sort of thing you need to simplify. The X window system was similar. It was very bizarre, its build system. But on the upside, it came with the whole build system. And if you followed the right instructions, you could build X, and it would work pretty well. It'd just take a month of Sundays. And that's fine. So X had that bizarre iMake system or whatever it was. And it may have made sense back in the day. And it does predate the GNU project. So AutoConf and so on weren't available back in the day. That's probably why it exists. They have since broken stuff out from monolithic packages, and I think they've gone to AutoConf style configuration, and it works. It's a lot easier to build things in the X project now because they've simplified their build environment quite a lot. LibreOffice has done the same thing with the OpenOffice code base. They've simplified things quite a lot, and as a result, the software actually starts a lot faster than it used to, and it's quite a lot more stable. So they made a lot of improvements to the software by simply cleaning up the code, cleaning up dependencies, removing unneeded ones, and you can save yourself a lot of work down the road if you simply look at every time you're going to add a dependency to your project, consider carefully a few points. First, do I really benefit from using this dependency? And by that, I mean, does the project benefit as a whole? Am I using the dependency just to avoid doing one tiny task, one relatively simple task? Am I using the dependency as a crutch to avoid writing 4 or 5 lines of code, or even 25 lines of code? Am I just using the dependency because someone told me to? Think that sort of thing through. If you determine after thinking that through that yes, the dependency has some benefit and it might be useful in the future for other things and so on, okay, maybe you we'll want to use it. But otherwise, it's worth taking a little bit of time now and doing something else to avoid the dependency. And that may simply be looking through your existing list of dependencies and see if you've got something in there that already does that. Redundant dependencies are definitely a problem because you can start ending up with a fight between them. Now, if you've decided there's some benefit to this extra module that you want to tack on to things, now you need to look at availability. How readily available is it? How well maintained is it? How likely are people to already have it installed? How easy is it to install if people don't already have it? That sort of thing. And if it turns out that this is a difficult thing to install, and people aren't likely to already have it, say it doesn't come with standard distributions of the operating system, you know, that sort of thing, then you might want to rethink using that as a dependency, unless you can ship the dependency yourself. And really, if it's a build time dependency, which and you're shipping source code, make sure it's actually going to make the build simpler and not just have an extra dependency. Because most people that might be building your software from the source have no idea how to troubleshoot it when dependencies go wrong. So if it's something that's needed to build the source code, well, consider shipping the thing that's generated by this tool pre-generated in your source distribution, and then only people that need to modify that need that extra tool. So for instance, the Lemon parser generator is one such tool. You might have a parser that you need to build and you've decided to use Lemon to construct it. That's not a bad choice, by the way. Lemon's pretty decent. You don't actually need to ship Lemon You don't need to rely on people having Lemon. Sure, you ship the input file for Lemon, but you also ship the output file from Lemon, and because that's there, Lemon isn't needed to actually build your project. And presumably, you're not dynamically generating the input for a parser generator, so it's probably fine. So that's an example of remove the build time dependency in the source code that you ship, and it can be real easy to do that. You can eliminate a lot of build time dependencies just by shipping the their output pre-built in your distribution package. So, really, the whole point of all of this is that I wanted to talk about and make the point that just because there's a module that does what you want to do, it doesn't mean it's the best solution or even a good solution. It's not necessarily a bad solution either, but it's something that you should think about carefully before you actually depend on that module. If you do decide, hey, it makes sense, be aware of the pitfalls. What if the module author abandons it or changes it incompatibly or something like that? So you might want to look at how much history does the module have and that sort of thing, and how stable has it been and all of that stuff. And then you need to make sure you stick to the public interfaces and all of that stuff, just to minimize the chances that things will go wrong. So, third-party dependencies, they're not evil. So don't take this as a rant against dependencies as a whole. If there are dependencies that make sense, by all means use them. But be aware of the potential pitfalls when you do. And having 3 or 4 or even a handful of external dependencies for your project is probably not the end of the world. But having 60 or 70 probably is. I'm going to finish with a couple of problems I had with software packages back in the day. First, there's GNU Cache, which is a sort of bookkeeping program, finances-wise. And then there's the GNOME desktop environment. Now, GNOME was pretty much impossible to build from the source back in the day. It had circular dependencies. And yes, circular dependencies, where you had to build a dependency, build a software package that build software package X that depended on software package Y before you could build software package Y. So if you didn't already have one of those installed, you couldn't build either one. So there was a bit of a bootstrap problem with GNOME. And there were a few things that GNOME depended on that were impossible to install because the documentation, you needed a PhD in whatever that software package was for to understand the installation process. And that was certainly not helpful. There were no clear instructions how to install anything in some of these packages. So GNOME was a bust for installing from source. It was nearly impossible to do. And I tried, and I never succeeded in doing it myself on a clean system. GNU Cache, on the other hand, was reasonably okay. It had quite a large list of dependencies, most of which were fairly reasonable. But it depended on one package, I think it was Guile, that was nearly impossible to understand how to install properly unless you were an expert with Guile. Now, you needed it to build GNU Cache, but you didn't need to know Guile to use GNU Cache. So I was trying to install the program, right? But it wanted Guile. And So I thought, okay, well, this is no problem. I'll grab Guile. I'll install it. I grabbed it. I built it, and it didn't work. And that was a huge problem. So I just said, screw it, and I didn't use GNU Cache. And now they've since cleaned up some of this nonsense. But what the problem was in this case was, like some of those dependencies for GNOME, was you had to do certain things to make Guile work. But those things were so mysterious to someone who doesn't know Guile and doesn't understand how the whole system works, that you had no hope. It wasn't even a learning curve. It was a learning cliff, and you were falling off the top of it, right? So this is the sort of way that dependencies go horribly wrong. Now, both of those projects have substantially improved their situation, the GNOME and GNU Cache, and I think the Guile people fixed whatever issues there were with their installation. There's still stuff out there that requires a PhD in some obscure software operations to actually install it, and that's simply not acceptable. And if that's the type of thing that your software depends on, you have failed as a software developer. No matter how hard it makes your life, do not depend on things like that, where an ordinary person not intimately familiar with the package cannot install it. Anyway, that's enough of a rant on this stuff for now. I'm probably going in circles by now, so no point continuing there. Anyway, if you want to be notified of future videos, make sure to subscribe and turn on notifications. If you liked the video or you didn't, leave a like or a dislike as you see fit. And if you've watched this far, thanks for watching.